Good morning. How about this one? Oh, we'll do that one. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Summer is winding down. Activities that are different than the ones we usually have during the school year are pulling us away a little bit less. So it was great to see church full last week. We hope to see that continue. And again, on behalf of everyone here, the pastoral staff, you're all welcome. We are all an important part of this congregation, and it is a blessing to know that we have a church home here at Carmichael. We would like to show a video this morning regarding an upcoming blood drive at Sacramento Adventist Academy. Lorenzo, if that's ready, go ahead and do that.
I came today to donate because I think it's such a worthwhile cause. You know, I have family members that have had health issues and friends and family who've had issues where they've needed blood. And so to me it's really important, and I really like too that this blood drive is held at a school because it's teaching a valuable lesson to our students and really kind of getting them started on becoming a lifelong donor.
The best part about donating for me is being able to help somebody else, help save a life.
Well, I've been donating blood.
I came today to donate because I think it's such a worthwhile cause. You know, I have family members that have had health issues and friends and family who've had issues where they've needed blood. And so to me it's really important, and I really like too that this blood drive is held at a school because it's teaching a valuable lesson to our students and really kind of getting them started on becoming a lifelong donor.
The best part about donating for me is being able to help somebody else, help save a life.
Well, I've been donating blood since I was in high school, and I do it, it's a way to give back to the community. And it saves lives. I know that for a fact. So it's a way of just me trying to be a good, productive citizen.
I think there's a real need for blood donations in our community, and it helps our medical staff to be able to give the care that needs to be given when it needs to be given.
So I chose to donate blood for the first time because I have heard from so many different people that it's a good thing to do and that it does save lives. And then also I got to see the facility where all the blood goes through, and it just made me, it cemented the idea that yes, this is absolutely good.
It was pretty simple, a pretty short process too. All you'll feel is like a little sting, but it's more than worth it when you can help save other people's lives and reach out to the community and stuff.
It just means that I feel like I'm doing my good deed of the day, just helping other people in need.
It means a lot. I get to save lives and help others, is which I love to do. Making sure like others are doing well, and me being able to give something that I have plenty of is a great feeling.
To me, thank you. Donating blood means that I can help. That, you know, it's an easy way for me to help and give back, and really do something meaningful for somebody.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. In the library at SAA, please be there. I think another component of this that is valuable, our students put this together. They coordinate this. It is an opportunity for them to grow in leadership. Jake Calkins has done a great job. Lorenzo Pena is also involved. I assume when Jake graduates, Lorenzo will take it over. So thank you for being a part of that. Matt, would you come up and update us on where things are at SAA?
Good morning, church. It is good to be here. I'm here for two reasons. The first is just to say thank you again. SAA wouldn't be the school that it is. We wouldn't be able to do all the wonderful things that we do in each class, when we go out and perform, when we're competing athletically, if it wasn't for the support of all of our churches, but specifically this church. We rely on you so much for all that we're able to do. And we don't say thank you enough. We don't get up here enough. So I'm here to kind of start that trend of saying thank you more frequently. The second reason I'm up here is to give you some very, very good news about SAA. Last year, we ended the school year with 229 students, a fantastic number, 229 hopefully souls for the kingdom. But this year, we ended our first full week of school with 249 students. Amen. A fantastic increase of 20 students across all grade levels. And I want to break down that number just a little bit. This is really exciting for me. Of our 201 available students that could have, 210 available students that could have returned to SAA, we had 200 of those students return, a 96% retention rate. Average, a really good number for Christian schools is 83%. So we are retaining our students very well. Second number I want to share, of our 249 students this year, 49 of those are brand new students. And 22 of those students are non-Adventists. Again, growing our kingdom. And the last number that I want to share with you is a financial number. We budgeted this year on 230 students, thinking that we would trend similarly. We're obviously 19 ahead of where we budgeted. So I'm really excited about a very strong year for SAA. I'm very excited that we're growing. And I just want to again say thank you and remind you that even though we're growing, even though we're doing very well, we still want your support. We still need your support. So please keep us in your prayers. Please stop by and visit. See all the wonderful things that are going on campus. And again, thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Christian education is a very competitive field, and to hear that we have so many non-Adventist students in our academy is not just something to be thankful for. It's a real opportunity for us. So that is great news. I want to just highlight a few announcements here. As with the school year starting out, not just at SAA, but for some of our students who are at other schools, so are a lot of our other programs ramping up. Some of our ministries that are going to be getting underway in the fall. The health ministries would like to remind you that October 6th through the 29th, on Tuesdays and Thursdays, 7 to 8:30, Diabetes Undone is a program that will be presented by health ministries. More information, of course, in the back. Carmichael Cougars, Pathfinder Club. They're off to a great start this year. Again, I want to remind, ages 10 to 15, great time to join still. I spoke with Karen earlier today. She wanted me to remind Karen Yao that Adventurers Club, ages 4 through 4th grade, their first meeting will be September 19th. Now, I understand that that date, there's also a parenting seminar at 2 o'clock. So for those who maybe would like information about both or who are going to attend one versus the other, there will be a child drop-off in the youth chapel at 1:45, okay? So you can attend either, all right? The Clarion is sent out electronically. If you would like to be added to that distribution list, please take the cards in the pew in front of you and just include your information, your email address, and who you are. These flowers, I haven't seen Pastor Benji and Stephanie today. Maybe they are not here, but these flowers are in honor of their 15th anniversary. I remember being part of the search committee, having the opportunity to be part of the search committee, and I remember what I thought when I first met them. I just thought to myself, wow, what a wholesome couple. What a blessing it would be to have them here. And so with that said, congratulations on your 15th anniversary, Pastor Benji and Stephanie, and we're so glad to have you here at our church. Finally, we have the first meeting of the C.S. Lewis Book Club coming up Thursday, September 17th. Vic and Jana lead out in that. Thank you for that ministry. In addition, I would also like to welcome Rachel Holman from Capital City. She will be doing our special music today. Our offering this week is for church budget. Large part of church budget, as you heard Matt attest to, is SAA. But as we know, there's so many other parts to it. We alluded to some of them, the ministries that we have available to our kids, to those, to the other parts of the congregation, whether they be adults, our Sabbath schools. Has anyone I'm just curious, I know that on this side, that's the side that I'm usually on, that's where the little kids are. Over the course of the last few weeks, since I attend Sabbath school over there, I've been up and down that hallway. If you get a chance, some Sabbath, come to Sabbath school first. Second, go up and down that hallway and see those two Sabbath school classes and how full they are. There must be some correlation between that and what's going on at SAA, Matt. So please give. Our responsibilities are not just to ourselves and just to the church as a fiscal responsibility, but our responsibility financial is also to the future of this church, this community, and our school. I'd like to have prayer for our service today. Please bow your heads. Dear God, thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for the blessing of this church, which will celebrate a wonderful anniversary this year. Thank you for our pastoral staff. We entrust them to you. We ask you to be a part of this service, to lead and to bless. And we thank you for the many blessings that we each enjoy in our own lives. In your name we pray, amen.
Good morning. How do we bless the Lord? We're continually asking Him to bless us. How do we bless Him? When we lift up our voices in praise, that is a blessing to Him, to His ears. We bless Him the way we live our lives, as we follow Jesus. Let's stand together as we sing, "Bless the Lord, O my soul."
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship His holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship His holy name.
You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name. I worship Your holy name. I worship Your holy name.
Let's spend a few moments getting acquainted with those who are seated nearby.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Your eyes, the world away. Ladies, that was a beautiful rendition of You're Beautiful. I'm reading from the New King James Version. The verse is Mark 14, verses 3 and 4. The context is Jesus at the anointing at Bethany. And the text reads, "And being in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table," meaning Jesus, "a woman came having an alabaster flask of very costly oil of spikenard. Then she broke the flask and poured it on his head. But there were some who were indignant among themselves and said, 'Why was this fragrant oil wasted?'"
Okay, boys and girls, it's time to come down for the children's story. Make sure you grab any available money on the way down. Yes, sir. Is it working? It's not.
morning, boys and girls. How are you today? Buenos días a todos. Feliz sábado. ¿Cómo están ustedes? Hola, ¿cuántos de ustedes me entienden? ¿Algunos de ustedes que hablan español? Sí, unos cuantos pocos. What other languages? So I was speaking a little bit in Spanish. How many of you speak Spanish? Ah, sí. How many of you speak other languages besides English? Yeah, a few other languages. What do you speak?
I also speak Chinese.
Excellent, very impressive. Oh, let's see, what languages do you speak?
Korean.
You speak Korean, okay. I know a few words in Korean. Any other languages?
German.
German, excellent. Somebody over here, okay, let's see. What language do you speak?
Portuguese.
Portuguese, that's an excellent language. My great-great-grandparents spoke Portuguese, I like that. So what language did Jesus speak? He spoke every language, that's right. When he was in heaven and now he speaks and he understands everything. But when he was on earth, when he took human form, what did he speak? Do you know what his first language was?
Hebrew?
Probably not. Close. Any other guesses? Okay, shout it out. He didn't speak English. At least not when he was on earth. Sometimes it can seem like it. So actually, Jesus' first language was a language called Aramaic. Close to Hebrew, and he probably learned to read and write Hebrew and a little bit of Greek. Right? Very smart guy. Pretty smart guy. A lot like some of you who speak a couple of different languages. Well, for me, I had to learn Spanish. My parents only speak English. So I had to learn it a little bit like what Jesus had to do. And when you're learning a language, it's a big experience. And so I went through a couple different things. One of the things I like to do is I was in a country called Argentina. And in Argentina, they play a lot of soccer, that's right. And so I used to spend my time playing soccer, having a good time, trying to learn a little bit of the language. I learned some basic words, right? Like, what would this be called in Spanish? Anybody know? A football? That's close. You call it a pelota, right? Or balón, right? Just depends where you are. So I was picking up words here and there. Right? Learning a few things about soccer or football. Goal, right? Everybody knows that, right? Goal. But I learned something really important. So I picked up a few words, and I was lucky to be studying at an Adventist school, and I was going to church, and I was making friends there, and people said, Brian, can you pray? And this is in Spanish. And I realized, sure, I knew a few words, but I couldn't pray in Spanish. And so I said a few words. I said, uy, querido Padre Nuestro, right? Because that's how what I heard other people say, que estás en los cielos. But it wasn't me. And then I said, querido Jesús, dear Jesus, just like I would say in English. But then I learned I prayed in English. And you want to know why? That's what Jesus did. When he went and he said he prayed in Aramaic, he knew when I speak to the Father, this is something that's personal. It's something that's inside of me. It's something where I want him to know what I say. But no matter what, Jesus understands you. If you say, querido Jesús, if you say, dear Jesus, if you say, Padre nuestro que estás en los cielos, he knows what you're saying. If you say it in German or if you say it in Portuguese, Jesus understands you. He understands your heart. He knows what you're saying, and he wants to hear from you. So when you pray, pray with me now. Dear Jesus, thank you for always hearing us. No matter what language we're using, we love you. Amen. Okay, go back to your seats.
Take the soccer ball. Oh boy.
will sing a new song to you, my God, on the 10-stringed lyre. I will make music to you. Well, I don't have a 10-stringed lyre, but I've got a 6-string guitar, and we're going to sing a new song that we've learned this week. We probably aren't going to completely memorize it the first time through, but hopefully we'll sing it again sometime in the future. It's a fun song titled King of Love, and it's written by and sung by a group of young adults from Carson City, Nevada. So it's kind of a local group.
King of love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever. And he is mine forever. Where streams of living water flow, my ransomed soul he leadeth. Where the verdant pastures grow, with fruit celestial feedeth. Never yet loving he sought me, on his shoulders gently laid, and home rejoicing brought me. In death's dark veil I fear no ill, with thee, dear Lord, I side me. Thy rod and staff my comfort still, cross before to guide me. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul, on the mountain high or in the valley low, the King of love my shepherd is, the King of love my shepherd is. Faileth never. Good Shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever. Within your house forever.
Amen for a new song. The next one is a familiar song. At least you think it is when you look at the title and the words. It's a little bit different rendition, so if you care to join us, sing along with us. If not, just enjoy the words. This is my Father's world. Sometimes we look around and we say, whose world is this anyway? You know, but God's still in control, isn't he?
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings, and round me rings the music of the spheres, the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas. His hand the wonders wrought. His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. Declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass, I hear him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. This is my Father's world. This is my Father's world. Oh, yeah. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. Why should my heart be sad? The Lord is King. Let the heavens ring. The Lord is King. Let the heavens ring. The Lord is King, let the heavens ring. God reigns, let the earth be glad. God reigns, let the earth be glad. God reigns, let the earth be glad.
Let the earth be glad. Let the earth be glad.
We're ready for our prayer time, and we're going to sing a couple of verses here in the chorus, Amazing Grace, and then we will invite you to kneel for our prayer. Sing this next verse, and then we can kneel as we sing together.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns unending.
Pray to our Heavenly Father. Father in heaven, we have come here on this beautiful Sabbath morning to worship, to praise you, and to thank you for what you do for us. We thank you for this Sabbath day. A day of rest where we can come apart from the cares and the perplexities and the challenges of everyday life and spend time here in worship with you in a quiet, safe place. Thank you for the Sabbath. And we pray just now that as we worship together, that our worship will be fully acceptable and pleasing to you. We pray for healing this morning, Lord. There may be someone here who needs financial healing, looking for work. There may be someone here that needs vocational healing. There may be others here this morning who need relational healing or social or mental healing. And there may be some here in the sound of my voice this morning, Lord, that need physical healing, either healing from an injury or from an illness. And there may be someone who has come here this morning who needs spiritual healing. Lord, whatever the healing need is, we just ask now that you will place your healing hand upon all of us. And heal us, Lord, according to your will. We thank you for our pastoral staff. We thank you for Caleb. And we pray just now that you will use Caleb this morning as an instrument of your love and peace that you created him to be. And the message that he presents to us today, Holy Spirit, instill within our hearts to listen and to hear the message that you have for each one of us individually. We love you, Lord. We thank you for all that you do for us. We long for the day when you will come and take us home with you. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns unending.
Hello, hello. All right. Man, Wilson family, don't tell my mom that you got Kevin to do that, okay? So none of the rest of you either. My mom, every Thanksgiving, the first thing she does when we walk in the door, my two younger brothers and I, is she asks us if we're going to sing with her that week. And so Ed and Terry, thank you for your music. Kevin, thank you for joining them. And don't tell my mom. All right. Jeff and Jolie, would you guys like to come up? Yeah, thank you. So a few weeks ago, we had an event here called the Willow Creek Global Leadership Summit. And I asked Jeff and Jolie to come and share their experience. It's not happening again for another 11 months, but I figured you can mark it on your calendars and be thinking ahead about it. So we just want to share how it went and kind of the reflections on it. So Jeff, why don't you start us out? What was it like? What do you enjoy about the Leadership Summit?
Well, this was my second year being part of Global Leadership Summit. Mm-hmm. And in my work, I'm entrusted with a number of teams, and I love to see their success. I love to work with them and help them all grow. Mm-hmm. But I have to confess that probably too often, when things get really crazy, it's easy to slip into a self-preservation mode. Mm-hmm. And yeah, looking at my schedule and what do I have to get done, and what are my deliverables. And what I really get, especially out of this year, it seemed to be a lot of focus on what I would describe as servant leadership. Mm-hmm. and focusing on how I can better serve the people I'm working with. And yeah, one of the speakers, there's some outstanding speakers. Jim Collins has written a number of books. And one of the things that he said that really, really caught me was, caring for your unit, not your career. Mm. Sorry, there's some.
Can we get the monitors off?
Feedback.
Do that?
So looking at whatever that unit is, for me, you know, I was relating it to the teams that I'm entrusted with.
Yeah.
And the work that I do, and focusing on how can I make them successful, and making that the focus of what I do, and you know, I could go on and on about the different speakers and the things they said, but that was really kind of the primary theme that I got.
All right, thanks. Jillie, how about you?
Okay, I know right now half of you are tuning this out because you think this does not apply to you, and that was me. Jeff came home a year ago, and he'd been to this conference for 2 days, and he was so excited, and he said, oh, you have to go, you have to go to this conference, it's so great. I thought, well, that's really nice, honey, but I don't lead people, so it probably doesn't apply to me. Okay, that's not true. There are 3 small people that report to me at home. But at work, no one reports to me. I don't lead any groups or teams or anything like that, so I didn't really think this applied to me. I thought, well, this is a business thing, that's great, and he was happy, and that was great. But he said, no, this, you have to get all your CCK people, and you guys have to go to this. And so it was a year away, and I said, okay, yeah, we'll look at that. And we didn't really talk about it again. And then about June, he said to me, okay, it's coming up, it's in August, and you gotta sign up, and he gave me the dates, and you know, it was just something I wasn't really looking at. And pretty soon he came home and he said, okay, I signed you up. Oh, okay, good. I'll find someone to watch the kids, no problem. So I have to say that it was amazing. It completely surprised me what it was about. And I am here to tell you that this applies to every single person here. If you lead people at work, of course, this is going to benefit you. If you lead a ministry, if you work with people at all in any capacity, you will find something that to bring home from this. It was inspiring, and I think that you would be really blessed. And I think that we put important dates on our calendar really far ahead, like birthdays or Christmas vacation or the next vacation we're taking. I know your phones are out, so open your calendars right now and put August 11 and 12, 2016 down. These are 2 days that are worthwhile. Take off the time now, schedule it away from work. It's worthwhile. You will be blessed. I promise.
All right, thank you so much. Can you give them a hand? Thank you for coming up here and sharing. So August 11 and 12, we really want to make sure that all our volunteers can go because it is something that helps us just learn how to work together better, just really accomplish more. So be looking forward to that next year. All right, Hosea and Tina, would you like to join us up here? Hosea and Tina have been doing a great ministry, have been leading a great ministry called the Grief Recovery Group. And we thought that we'd take this opportunity to let you guys know about it, what's going on, and kind of what their passion is for this. So Tina, why don't you start us out? How did this start? What was kind of the beginning of this? And just hold it up close.
It was a couple of us who felt impressed and called to have something in a church, like small groups, and especially I noticed that there's a lot of people who are grieving or who are going just for the change in life, which is again loss, because we are losing something common and known and entering in something challenging and kind of scary. So I had that in my heart for a year, and then I talked with Pastor Caleb and Kathleen and Hosea, Janice, and we somehow got together and started this group, and we feel blessed.
Nice. And Hosea, what happens at the group?
Well, we have a spiritual ministry, and I lead out in the spiritual ministry. We've been reading the book Communion with God. It teaches you how to present yourself to the Lord in prayer, which is very important to grief recovery. And I'm also recommending another book called Surviving Grief. Excellent book. Takes you through the 5 stages of grief. Lets you know that you won't always feel this way. That though your life will be changed, but it will be for the better. As the Holy Spirit has blessed us, we've unified. We've become a social group as well as a spiritual group. We eat together. We socialize together. We pray together. And we have branched out into ministry. We have some ladies who love to cook in our group, so our talents are being displayed. Janice Morse is one of them, and Eileen Butler. They cook delicious, and we're delivering dinner today to 2 of our homes of our sick and shut-in, people who Carrie recommended to me they could use food there. Mm-hmm. So we're going to take food to them, we visit with them, we find out what their spiritual needs are, and we pray with them in their homes. It's been a real blessing. You feel that you're not alone. Yeah. In their group. You know, when you lose a loved one, And this book covers it, especially a spouse. At the top of the scale of stress is the loss of a spouse. This little book covers the loss of a spouse, written by the wife, and also the loss of her son. The loss of a child is a different kind of grief. We grieve differently, but we all grieve. And we reverently listen to each other, and we simply listen to whatever another person wants to express about their grief or share, and then we pray together. It's just been a real growth experience.
Now, Tina, who should come to this?
I think each of us, as soon as we are born, experience the loss. We are, you know, getting out of the warmth and something known, and with a cry, we really are entering the change and insecurity. Mm-hmm. And since then, our lives are in constant change, aware of not, we are going through it. The most important thing is how we, what we learn from that, and how that can empower us. Going along in this process is hard, so that's why we have this group, to support each other, to feel safe, to be with like-minded people, people who offer their love, but also what we Christians have, God's unity and love. And that's precious.
Yeah. Now, when is this meeting? If somebody's interested, how can they be part of this?
Yes, every Sabbath right now, we're meeting on Sabbath afternoon right after church, 12:30, whenever church lets out, over in the early teens room, which is, you know, right out to your left. Just before you go out the back doors, go to your left, right up the stairs is the early teens room. And anyone who would like to come, if you just want to get information, I have some information about various books on grieving, which covers different types of grief and different types of losses. And also, I've experienced people in this church who have no family, but they have a little doggy, a pet. And if that little doggy were to die, they would be all alone. We invite you to come. It's still a type of grief. That's how far out we go with grief. And so we want to keep the service available to the church. If anyone wants to come by and just speak with us or pray with us or talk with us or get some information about good literature on grieving, we'd love to have you come by. 12:30.
All right, well, that's our producers letting us know we're out of time. But thank you so much for sharing. Yeah, we appreciate it. You know, anytime you're in a big church, it can feel like you're going through things alone, just because we don't know everything that's going on in people's lives. So I wanted to make sure that you knew there was this available, and also just encourage you. The pastoral staff can't find out about things unless you're willing to share it with us. So I know I speak on behalf of myself and everyone else that if you'd be willing to tell us, we'd love to just walk with you through whatever you're going through. Okay. So first of all, I want to offer an apology. For those of you who got our e-note, I said this week that I'm talking about two people in the Bible, but I'm actually only talking about one because of time. So I know somebody already complained to me that she already knew who I was going to be speaking about, so I had to have somebody else so she'd still listen. But it's okay. Hopefully it'll still be interesting. So we're going to be looking at the story of the woman who anointed Jesus in Mark 14. And just to give you some background on why we're looking at this, there was a change that happened after Jesus went up to heaven. The disciples and the followers of Jesus had always had these things that they had done or not done that let people know that they were Jews following the one true God. Now, some of the things they didn't do was that they didn't break the Ten Commandments. They didn't do things that would make them unclean, all these things. And the things they did do was they participated in the different feasts. They would travel to Jerusalem, and they would give sacrifices. They would also give different sacrifices of thanksgiving to God, thanking him for the harvest, for the different things he was doing in their lives. And they were offering these sacrifices. But then for the new church, they were wondering, which of these do we keep on doing And how do we transition? And I think that as Adventists, we still, these are things we still wrestle with. I know for me growing up, and this was, I went to College View Academy in Lincoln, Nebraska, and this well could have just been me, but I focused more on the things I wasn't supposed to do, mainly because there were consequences for doing them. I was at a camp meeting, I was talking with two unnamed people in our conference leadership, and we were saying that when we're interviewing pastors, we should, as one of the questions, ask them if they got in trouble for talking in middle school or high school. And if they didn't, it's probably not going to work out. Like, because we, as we were comparing stories, we realized that for every one of us, our teachers had signaled us out for special consideration. For me, I remember one class, it was in eighth grade, and normally the desks were just, you know, kind of like this together. I think I had 22 students in my class. But for some reason, towards the end of the year, they started getting farther and farther apart. And pretty soon, I was in the very front of the class, the very front left. So I actually had to turn, and I just got to see the side of my teacher. And I was right next to the teacher, could be right here, keeping watch over me. And then my best friend, Jeff Blake, he would sit on the very back right. But the problem was, is we were such good friends. You know, you have, I'm sure this happens with your spouse as well, where you hear something, and you can look at each other, and you know what they're thinking. And so I remember this one time, my teacher, Mr. G, that's all the detail I'm going to give, he said something, and I was like, oh, I can't believe he just said that. And I looked all the way around and made eye contact with Jeff, and we started cracking up laughing. I can't remember what happened after that. I kind of blanked out, but it wasn't good. But anyway, I graduated, and here I am to God. Here I am today. Praise God. So just because there are consequences, it's easy to focus on the things we aren't supposed to do. Because it would be really awkward, you know, for those of us who went to Adventist education, it would be awkward to get in trouble for not doing good things. You know, if you're going home to your parents, hey, I see there's a note from your teacher. What happened? Well, I wasn't joyful enough in worship this week. I guess I was frowning while I was singing Jesus Loves Me, and not supposed to happen again. You know, that's not possible to do. It's awkward. You know, so we don't do it. But the problem is that we end up focusing on the things we talk about. And so because we talk about not breaking the rules, it's easy to identify as a people group and to have what distinguishes us from other people be what we don't do. And it's interesting because throughout the Bible, it seems like Jesus and God had an equal mix on, yes, you don't do things, but you do other things. And if we neglect that, I think it leaves us in a kind of awkward place, because as I know I've met Seventh-day Adventists too, and I'm just going to use something from my friends in the South, God bless them, where it seemed like they felt like the more that they loved Jesus, the more things they were supposed not to do. And so I talked to them, and, you know, having conversations, and, well, you know, I love God, so I don't wear any big jewelry. And like, well, I love God, so I don't wear any big jewelry, and also I don't wear earrings. Well, I don't wear a necklace. Well, I don't wear friendship bracelets. You know, like, oh, okay. You know, I don't wear multicolored socks. You know what? And because they wanted to somehow grow in the things they were excited about God, they wanted to be able to show that. And that you see the same thing like in friendships or marriages, where saying no to some things is really good, but if you kept on trying to impress the person by how many things you said no to, at one point it would get kind of awkward. You know, like let's say that I think having I'm single, I'm not married, but I think having boundaries in relationships is really good. You know, and so, you know, tell if you're a husband telling your wife, you know, I'm going to have boundaries, so I'm not going to go on any trips with somebody of the opposite sex. You know, okay, that's good. That's probably like long trips. That's wise. But if they grow in loving you and they wanted to show it, it would be awkward if they kept on saying like, well, you know, I love you so much now that I'm not going to ride in the car with somebody of the opposite sex. Well, now I love you more, so I'm not going to talk to a woman. At one point, it gets kind of weird. And I believe this is one of just my themes as a pastor, is I believe that God's calling us back to focus on the things we're supposed to be doing instead of only focusing on things we aren't supposed to do. Because yes, it's wise. Some things will mess you up in life. But I feel like what God is really looking for us to do is to participate with him in the good things we're doing, in the good things that he's doing. So we're going to look at that today. And I think that we can sum it up in Romans 12:1. Here, Paul has just shared with people about the gospel and how they're invited into the family of God. And he says, then I appeal to you therefore, so because of everything else that I've just talked to you about, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So here Paul is saying, you know, you used to offer sacrifices of animals, but now God doesn't want that. He wants you. He wants your life. He wants the things you do, the things you focus on, just your life in general, to be a sacrifice to him. And you see this also in Colossians 3:17. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And so this, I think, is where God's wanting to take us, to the place where our lives in general are just giving thanks to him. We're living sacrificially for God. And I love this story of the woman anointing Jesus, because I think it really gives us a picture of why this is important. I think Jesus thought this was an important moment as well, because after this story happens, he tells everybody around, truly, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. So Jesus is saying that this story that we're going to look at today, anytime that people hear about the gospel, hear the good news that I have provided a way to be united with God, hear the good news that they can be invited into the family of God, that none of their past matters, it's all an open invitation. Anytime that's proclaimed, what she has done will be told in memory of her. And so we're going to look at this story and see why is this a big deal. What happens is that Jesus comes to the house of Simon. Now, he's had the triumphal entry. The chief priests and Pharisees are really upset at him. They're trying to figure out how to kill him. And then Jesus comes into this house to eat. Now, while he's eating, this woman comes in. We aren't told anything about her, but this woman comes in, and she has a bottle of perfume, and instead of having like a stopper or a spray bottle at the top, she just breaks the top off of it. So it had like a long stem neck, and she just breaks it off, and then pours it over his head and anoints him. Now, at this point, people in the room, Matthew tells us that it was the disciples, start to become indignant. They become upset. Why was this wasted? Did Jesus really need that much perfume? Which I think speaks good to Jesus' bathing habits. You know, not everybody was like, oh, finally. You know, people said, oh, why was this necessary? That was too much. You know, moms, I'm sure maybe, not to these teenage boys, but I'm sure to some teenage boys at some point in your life, you might have told them, that's too much cologne. That's not needed. This a little bit would be good, and this is too much. And that's the idea that Jesus, that the disciples of Jesus are giving. This is a waste. It's not needed. It's too much. And then Jesus comes and tells them, do not be angry with her. She has given what she had. The thing that she had to give, that's what she gave to me. And don't get upset with her for it. She's anointed me for my burial, for my death and my burial. And so I want to just look at this story, and we're going to take three takeaways. Why did Jesus seem to think that this act was such a big deal, that he wanted to honor this woman in this way? So in Mark 14, after this had happened, there were some who said to themselves indignantly, why was the ointment wasted like that? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor. And they scolded her. So at this point, the woman's feeling down. She, just out of the goodness of her heart, she wanted to give something to Jesus, and this is what she had to give. And then people are getting upset at her. But Jesus said, leave her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. For you always have the poor with you, and whenever you want, you can do good for them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for burial. And then Jesus again says, and truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed on the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. So I just want to have us look at three application points of this. And the first one is that I believe that what Jesus is getting at here, why he thinks this is such a big deal, is because this could be, I guess, summarized as kind of what the goal of the gospel is for him. That we would come to a place in our lives, in our trust with him, the people around us would say we're wasting our life on him. That our affection toward him, the time we spend on him and the things he wants us to do, is getting to the point of being wasteful. And it's interesting because depending on what group of people there is, will depend on what they consider wasteful. You know, someone who hates religion, anything you do is a waste. You know, anything you do for Jesus, that could have been done for somebody else. Why are you doing that? But for myself, what I feel like I'm in much more danger of is a feeling like I want to do things for God, but I need to be prudent. I want to do things for him. I want to trust him with my life, but not too much. You know, like let's be reasonable here. I still want to have a savings account. You know, I still want to have stocks. You know, I still want to have a house, have a car, have these things. And not that any of these things are bad, but the portion of my life that I'm willing to trust Jesus with gets smaller and smaller. Where it can get to the place where I tell Jesus, you know, whatever you want to do Saturday afternoon between 1 and 4 p.m., I'm yours. whatever you want to do with this 8% of money that I have left, you can do it. You know, because I want to be a part of what you're doing, God. Jesus, I want to make sacrifices for you, but I don't want to be carried away. And I love what Jesus says here, of that he fully affirms that she's given what she can. And so I invite you to, as a Christian, as somebody who's following Jesus, to ask yourself, what is something that God would want me to do, or something that he's calling me to do, that people who aren't following God would call wasteful? What's that thing that Jesus wants to partner with me in that doesn't make sense to people who don't know Jesus? It seems like there's a, and I'm just going to make the next one really quick. It seems like pretty obvious, but if you're presenting your life as a living sacrifice to Jesus, you are going to make sacrifices. You know, there are going to be things where you're not, you know, raising up the family pet and then taking him to the temple. You know, nothing like that. Thank you, Jesus. But as someone who's living for God, you aren't going to make that sacrifice, but there's probably going to be a sacrifice that God's going to be asking you to make. Now, that can be a sacrifice in your time, your money, the things you're focusing on, but most likely there'll be a sacrifice. Now, in your Connect card, I listed three sacrifices in the My Next Step category, okay? The first one is, I will make the sacrifice to commit to this church community and join a Sabbath school or small group. Now, this is a sacrifice because acquaintances don't cost you anything, but friends and community do. You know, if you just have lots of acquaintances, you can just go through life, and whenever you feel like hanging out with them, you can. Whenever you feel like doing something for them or helping them, you can. And whenever you don't want to, you don't have to. We're just acquaintances. If you get upset with them, you don't have to ask forgiveness. You just don't talk to them. You know, if you have a disagreement, if you don't agree on politics, or there's a misunderstanding, you don't have to go through the hard work of asking forgiveness or choosing to forgive them. You just don't hang out with them anymore. Or if they go to your church, you just sit in a different part of the church. You know, and then you can be nice because you're just acquaintances. But if you're friends, if you're committed, it's a sacrifice. You have to have those awkward conversations of, what you said really hurt me. I was upset about this. Or, I know you didn't mean it this way, but I need to forgive you for this. And sometimes people are going to need things and need help when you're tired or when the football game is on. You know, and it's going to cost you because real community does cost you. Second one is, I'll sacrifice blank minutes of my time each day in September for being with God. Now, maybe this is the thing you feel like God's calling you to do. You know, I'm so busy that I've been tempted to think that I should accomplish everything I need to do and then give God some of what's left over. You know, he understands how busy I am. He knows my schedule. He won't mind. And I'm just going to give him a couple minutes. And so this is just making a commitment of saying, you know what? I really want to grow in this friendship. I want to grow in trusting God. And like any relationship, I'm going to have to spend time with it to do that. Finally, the third option, I will sacrifice the time and energy it takes to lead or host a small group, mentor a younger Christian, or help someone know Jesus this year. Now, this is if your life is going good. You know, you've got some things that are tough, but you've got a handle on it. And maybe the sacrifice for you would be letting God know, God, I'm willing to help somebody know you. I'm willing to, for somebody who's just been baptized or kind of a new Christian, I'm willing to help them. I'm willing to get a group of my friends together and set apart time where we can get to know God better and talk about how we can apply living for him, how we apply those things to our life. And that's a sacrifice. You know, you could just sit home and watch Netflix at night. You could just come home and go to sleep early. And so the question is, God, am I at a place in my life where this is a sacrifice I can make? And then finally, the third thing is something Jesus says here. He brings out in verses 7 and 8. It says, for you will always have the poor with you, and whatever you want, you can do good for them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for burial. And the point I want to bring from this is, I think this was true then. And she got to anoint Jesus for burial, and other people tried to, and they were too late. You know, the three women on Sunday morning, they came down, went to the tomb, they had all the spices ready, they were going to anoint him for his burial, and the body wasn't there. You know, they wanted to do things, but they just didn't, they weren't able to. And I don't want this to be guilty at all, but there's just a reality that for giving gifts to God, gifts to Jesus, there are things we can do now for him that we can't do in heaven. You know, there are things that need to be done now. There are members of his family that are in trouble. There are people that don't know what he's like. You know, all these things that you can do now for God that he's not going to be upset with you if you don't do them. You know, he's not going to harbor a grudge, anything like that. But you only have a certain number of years where you can do something. You know, you can sing praises to him in heaven. You know, you can thank him in heaven. You can show him your love. All these things, and none of that will be rejected. But there are certain things that you've only got about 40 years time span to do it in. And I firmly believe that if you let God know you're willing to do things, he'll make it happen. Like Jesus said, she gave what she could. I don't think there's any of us that say, Jesus, you know, you've been really working in my life. I want to help somebody know you. And he's going to say, I'm sorry, you know, you're just not qualified enough. As long as we choose to give what we have to Jesus, he accepts it. And as you read through the Bible, it's amazing the things that happen because of it. You look at these different texts, and honestly, it looks like in heaven, people are kind of going overboard. You look at Revelation 4:8. And four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night they never cease to say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Now, that seems a little excessive, right? How many of you, don't raise hands, but after the worship team does a chorus for four times, you're like, whoa, God, let's not get excessive. You know, three times was plenty on that chorus. And here in heaven, we have this picture where they're singing the same chorus over and over and over again. And it's not just like a weekend chorus marathon. It says forever and ever. And as I read things about Ellen White's encounters with heaven or visions of God, or read about things that happened to John in Revelation or other Christians, like, you get the picture that in heaven, things are extravagant. You know, it's not like, oh, okay, we've got 15 minutes for worship and then we need to go. You guys all have houses to build. Good luck. It's like, things are extravagant. You know, Jesus is having to dodge crowns people are throwing at him. You know, he's like, we're not worthy. Angels in Revelation, they just tell about Jesus. People worship them because it's so hard not to. You know, I believe there's going to be a time in our lives where it's going to be really hard not to worship God. Like, we're told that the stones would cry out. It's just this automatic reaction. It's so hard to do anything besides worship. But now, we're living in a time where it's easy to have other choices besides worshiping. It's easy to have other choices besides sacrificing to God. And that's just a reality of the time we live in. But it's also an opportunity. You know, we get to praise him now. We don't have to wait until everybody knows who Jesus is and what he's done. Until every nation, every tribe confesses that he is Lord. We don't have to wait until that. We can do it now. We don't have to wait to talk about how good God is until we're surrounded by people who only think he's good. You know, we don't have to wait to share what he's done for us, to seek him, until a time where it's really easy. And I want to let you know that many of you, whether you're going through pain or just different troubles, it's a sacrifice to praise God now. And I think God honors that sacrifice. And so my hope for us is that we would be just reminded of the truth that God's worth it. That Jesus, we're not going to get to heaven and regret or think that we just spent too much on Jesus, that we lavished too much on him and we wasted some of our time. And so let's just remind each other of that, that Jesus is worth our time, he's faithful, and he's worth working with him and making sacrifices to help his will be done. Okay? Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you so much for living in the time we live, you know, where we can eat whatever food comes to mind, where we can hang out with friends, visit relatives. There's all these things that you've done for us, all these things that we're blessed with by living in America and living during this time in history. And God, we just pray that we would be open to you, that we would not forget that you're worth our sacrifice, that as Christians, we would be known as people who live sacrificially for you and for those around us. So God, I pray for myself and everyone here that you would keep those truths in our mind. Remind us that if we seek you, if we trust you, you won't let us down. And so I thank you, Father, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, even then God was faithful to me. Every word he's promised, it's true. What I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Looking back, his love and mercy I see, in my heart and fail to believe, yet he's been faithful to me. When my heart looked away, the many times I couldn't pray, still in love, God was faithful to me. The days I spend so selfishly reaching out for what pleased me. Even then, God was faithful to me. Every time I come back to Him, you see He's right there with His open arms, and I know again that He's been faithful.
Amen. I want to close with Psalm 50, verses 1 and 2. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in the mighty heavens. Praise Him for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. May you extravagantly praise God and live for Him this weekend. Amen.